I'm Neil Bhowmick at Cedars-Sinai Medical Center and the Samuel Oshin Cancer Institute in Los Angeles. My laboratory works on the role of the tumor microenvironment and its impact on tumor initiation, progression, and therapeutic resistance. For the purposes of the JCI publication, we use prostate cancer as our model system. Here, we wanted to better understand the mechanism by which carcinoma-associated fibroblasts, or CAF, have in promoting prostate cancer progression and therapeutic resistance. CAF are tumor-supportive cells that can have a driving role in tumor progression. And since the CAF themselves are not transformed, we examined its unique epigenomic signature as opposed to genomic and transcriptomic signatures that have been studied by many others in the past. Dr. Rajiv Mishra in the laboratory found that the CAF epigenome is distinct from that of the normal tissue fibroblasts. The difference was found to be central in the metabolic reprogramming of the adjacent tumor epithelia for tumor growth and the support of eventual resistance to the standard of care, which is androgen signaling inhibition. And it also shed light on a paradoxical observation where cancer aggressiveness seems to increase with the use of this androgen-targeted therapy. From work 20 years ago in Jerry Cunha's laboratory, we've known that carcinoma-associated fibroblasts can be isolated from prostate tumors and grown ex vivo for a period of time. These cells, once combined with non-tumorigenic epithelial cells, can form tumors. However, expanding these CAF in plastic over a time results in a diminished tumorigenic capacity. This suggested a form of short-term memory for these CAFs for the time when they were associated with the cancer epithelia. Similar prostate fibroblasts from non-cancerous tissues, also called NAF, are not able to cause this tumorigenesis of non-tumorigenic epithelia. This study, we looked more closely at the methylome differences that affected tumor metabolism as a form of memory by these tumor-supportive cells in prostate cancer patients. We identified a differential promoter methylation pattern in cancer and non-cancer-associated fibroblasts, but one gene in particular turned out to be worth pursuing. We found promoter hypermethylation in a gene called RASL3. Promoter methylation of RASL3 causes a downregulation of this gene's expression. RASL3 is a RAS gap, which is a GTPase activating protein for the RAS oncogene. By silencing the RAS activity inhibitor through epigenetic silencing of RASL3, it's like cutting the brake line. So RAS activity is elevated in the CAF in the absence of any mutations or any increase in total RAS expression. As evidence, we found greater downstream ERK and CRAF phosphorylation. With elevated RAS activity in the CAF, we found evidence of macropinocytosis. Macropinocytosis is a process of engulfment of proteins such as albumin for subsequent lysosomal degradation. But RAS mutations or amplifications are nearly unheard of in prostate cancer. And we didn't find any RAS amplification or change in expression in the prostate cancer epithelial cells. All the changes we noticed were actually just in the CAFs and the carcinoma-associated fibroblasts. We perform metabolome analysis on prostate cancer epithelial cells treated with conditioned media from either the human CAF or NAF cells. We found elevated levels of glutamine, glutamate, and other metabolites in the TCA cycle. Thus, the CAF was generating glutamine that was being taken up by the epithelia. We found greater proliferation of prostate cancer epithelia when combined in 3D cultures with dominant active RAS-expressing fibroblasts compared to the wild-type control fibroblasts. There was greater respiration and ATP generated in the epithelia with RAS-expressing fibroblasts around than when wild-type fibroblasts were associated with the epithelia. That stromal source of energy went away when we blocked glutamine uptake with an inhibitor called GPNA, which blocks SLC1A5. And this was not entirely surprising. The conditioned media from RAS-expressing fibroblasts turned on mTOR and the transcription factor FOXM1. The activation of FOXM1 resulted in turning on a whole panel of genes Misha Beltran had described some time ago to be a neuroendocrine differentiation signature for a prostate adenocarcinoma. This was important because we found that glutamine was sufficient and necessary all on its own to cause prostate cancer neuroendocrine differentiation. Glutamine seems to be serving at least two purposes: as a traditional source of energy via the TCA cycle for oxidative phosphorylation to enable tumor expansion, and two, more interestingly, glutamine was able to support neuroendocrine differentiation. As neuroendocrine differentiation is a very aggressive form of prostate cancer that these stromal epigenetic changes can induce, we thought maybe measurement of glutamine can be used to non-invasively monitor indolent and aggressive disease. Prostate development and cancer progression are dependent on androgens. So following local therapy like surgery or radiation, recurrent disease is inhibited by targeting the androgen signaling axis. And this normally works quite well for most patients. But androgen-targeted therapy only works for a limited amount of time. There are many ways therapeutic resistance can develop, and one such way is through neuroendocrine differentiation. Based on our data, CAFs can support this progression. So we wanted to know if androgens can regulate RACL3 epigenetic regulation in fibroblasts. Looking at the promoter methylation on the right, bisulfite sequencing demonstrated that, in fact, androgens could cause hypomethylation of RACL3 promoter in support of the elevated mRNA expression found with similar treatment of the CAF. This was especially eye-opening because it meant that non-cancer-associated fibroblasts, the NAFs, if exposed to androgen-targeted therapy, could turn on RAS activation through the silencing of RACL3. And this whole process would induce glutamine cascade that can act on the cancer and result in neuroendocrine differentiation. We measured serum glutamine levels in patients with differential therapeutic response to androgen deprivation therapy. We found that in 28 patients, there was a further elevation in glutamine in patients that were resistant to androgen-targeted therapy than those that showed biochemical or radiographic response to the therapy. And this is illustrated in the waterfall plot. These results supported our findings that we just demonstrated in mice and in culture. These experiments taught us that oncogenic RAS activation in CAF can support tumorigenesis and enable resistance to androgen-targeted therapy. We may have revealed one mechanism by which therapy-induced neuroendocrine differentiation occurs. Further, available glutamine uptake and metabolism inhibitors can complement standard of care androgen-targeted therapy. Finally, I want to give credit to the people that did the work that I just described. Dr. Rajiv Mishra was the lead author. He worked with members of our laboratory to make the exciting findings. And Jen-Q Liu provided the statistical support. Roberta Gottlieb was essential in guiding the metabolic work. Spectral magnetic resonance imaging was done by Sean Wagner in the Cedars-Sinai Imaging Institute, and Edwin Posadas provided the clinical translation for our bench findings with annotated patient samples. The study was supported by grants from the Veterans Administration, National Cancer Institute, and the Samuel Oshin Comprehensive Cancer Institute. Thank you for your time.